So I do want to share, like I said, some of the risk and protective factors that I've seen in my own clinical practice that have also been substantiated by the research. Again, the research is quite limited, so these are very preliminary ideas, and I suspect that as we have a deeper look into this and learn a bit more, some of these things we will find are not so significant, and there may be some things added to these lists. So this is very much an introduction to what's going on, what we're starting to see, and where we can kind of take the research from here. So the number one thing that's coming out in the research right now is, like I said, that autism itself does not increase risk for engagement in criminal behaviors, but they are finding that the co-occurring personality disorders, substance use, and mental health conditions can increase the risk. So all those complex layers added on top of each other will have the risk go up. And of course, this is the same in the general population as well. With regards to autism, some individuals with autism, as we know, have those executive functioning challenges, sensory sensitivities, and maybe some emotion regulation challenges. So this can be a risk factor in terms of what we've seen in the forensic system is a lot of the people who have an autism diagnosis in the system, a lot of the criminal behaviors that they engaged in were quite impulsive. And so you can imagine feeling overwhelmed and sensory overwhelming or emotionally overwhelmed can sometimes contribute to lashing out behavior, a very sudden behavior. Theory of mind idea. So some researchers believe that people who are on the autism spectrum have the potential to have some difficulty understanding the perspectives of other people and understanding what those thoughts might be of the other person. So you can imagine if you're having struggles with that, it would be hard to distinguish how your behaviors might be impacting other people. And so you can see in that sense how people may act in a certain way that is deemed to be criminal by society, but they may not have realize that what was going on there. Rigidity and narrow interests is an area that has been explored with regards to autism and criminal behavior. Two major behaviors that have been looked at the most, again in the limited research, is arson as well as stalking behaviors. And I believe that was already touched on a little bit today in Grace's presentation, but you can see how that having a narrow interest on somebody can result in a little bit of not really understanding the boundaries or what people might think is inappropriate and can contribute to some examples of stalking behaviors. Social isolation and bullying. So there was a recent study that came out, I think it's from the UK, where they looked at individuals who have an autism diagnosis and what were the criminal behaviors that they were engaging in and where was this happening. So they were trying to find out if there was a difference in this population. And what they did find was a significant number of the interpersonal aggression, violent acts that were carried out were at the school. And so the researchers were suggesting that perhaps this is coming out of some of that bullying, social isolation behaviors, and frustration, and that it's leading to that. A later age of autism diagnosis for several reasons. We can see why this might contribute to a lot of challenges. And one of them that I've seen in my clinical practice is not having, sometimes, not having that label that they can say, okay, this is why this is happening, or this is how I understand my own experience, sometimes can be difficult for people and it can get very confusing. And so that having that earlier diagnosis can help with supports, but also with a self-understanding. Family history and context, again, this applies to the general population, but I think it's very important for us to consider the outside and the system that's going on for these individuals that end up in the system. And so, of course, just like the general population in studies of individuals with autism, we see history of child abuse and neglect, and isolation and a family history of violent behavior can obviously increase that risk. And I do also want to talk today about protective factors, because I do think that, as mentioned, this can sometimes be not what is looked at in the research or not what is looked at in practice. And I think especially in the forensic system, sometimes there is a bit more of a a focus on what's gone wrong as opposed to what's going well and how can we increase that. And so I think it's quite important to bring that up. So some of the things that have come out in the research so far, there was a study, I think there's two studies done of forensic patients in the UK, in England, and with regards to alcohol and substance use after engagement in the forensic system. So again, this may or may not apply to the general population or to community, but they did find that once in the forensic system, individuals who have an autism spectrum diagnosis become significantly less likely to engage in any alcohol or substance use. And it's suggested that this may be as a result of having such rigidity and structure as an inpatient, but also as an outpatient. So in Canada, the provinces will give you kind of a list if you leave the hospital of the types of things that you're not allowed to do. And so they've found that along with the next point there about rule adherence, that individuals with autism are a lot more likely to follow those very closely for the long term. So this is a protective factor as well, in the sense that these individuals might actually not be returning to the forensic system and lower rates of recidivism than we're seeing in the general population. Because this is a new area of research, there isn't any data yet on recidivism rates. But so it's just kind of an idea that this might be happening. More amenable to affirm guilt. So this can be a protective factor in the sense that if an individual is connected to their community or they do have informal or formal supports, that they may be more likely to disclose some of the behaviors that they're engaging in before they come a higher risk. So in my clinical practice, in my private practice, I've certainly seen this a lot, and the clinicians across the Red Path Center, we've seen people who have therapists may speak to their therapists about some of the things that they're doing, and then that can be checked in at that point. Evidence-based interventions. So for example, this conference, there's some research coming out on how can we support ongoing mental health and well-being in individuals with autism. And so there is a lot of focus, or some focus on that area now, and a lot of evidence coming out. And so that is helpful for clinicians and individuals and families and communities to think about before entering the forensic system. What are some interventions that we can put in place, or what are some ways that we can better support people to reduce the risk of entering the system at all? And then once they're in the system, what are some interventions and treatments that can be happening for individuals to reduce recidivism, but also support as much a positive interaction with the forensic system as much as possible? And again, just like the general population, thinking about the family system and community involvement. So the research is showing that if an individual's family is more involved in their lives, if they've got those informal supports, if they have access to resources and services and interventions, and they're involved in their community, then the risk level goes down. And again, like I said, this applies to the general population as well.